A leading American scholar in the areas of systematic theology and culture, Catholic spirituality, and Catholic saints, Cunningham has edited or written over 25 books, far too many to name here today, including several on Thomas Merton. Thomas Merton, A Spiritual Master, A Search for Solitude, The Journals of Thomas Merton, 1952 to 1960, and Thomas Merton and the Monastic Vision, which I have here. In it, in the prologue, he quotes the witticism from the contemporary European Cistercian Dom André Louf, who asks, what is a monk? A monk is someone who every day asks, what is a monk? So with that, I'm sure that we'll be given deep insights today into who Thomas Merton was as a monk in his writing and contemplative life. He will speak to us today on Thomas Merton, the writing life, and the contemplative life. Please join me in greeting him today.
I'm not going to rehearse the life of Thomas Merton. I suspect that many people in this audience know of that life. I will only point out that on the 31st of January, I hope to be in New York City at the Church of Corpus Christi, where Thomas Merton was received into the Catholic Church. And the people at Corpus Christi are going to celebrate the 31st of January, which is Merton's birthday. He was born 100 years ago, as he says, under the sign of the water bearer in a little town in southern France, in Prades in France. I get emails all the time from people who say, what should I begin to read if I want to read about Thomas Merton? To which I always answer, which Thomas Merton do you want to read about? Do you want to read about Thomas Merton, the poet, the social critic, the writer on the spiritual life? Do you want to read about someone who was a kind of a theologian, writing in the autobiographical mode, and so on? He was enormously productive. He entered the monastery on December the 9th, 1941. He died exactly 27 years later outside of Bangkok, Thailand. And I remember seeing the New York Times, an obituary of Thomas Merton and an obituary of Karl Barth. They died on the same day. One of the old tough lay brothers at Gethsemane said to me one time, that's what Father Lewis gets for traveling about. If he stayed in the monastery, he'd still be with us today. I've decided today to reflect a little bit on Thomas Merton as a writer in relationship to his desire to be a contemplative monk. In 1947, 5 years a monk and 2 years before he was ordained to the priesthood, Merton published an essay on poetry and contemplation in Commonweal magazine. He had published a volume of poetry in 1944 called 40 Poems. He recognized that some poets, like his beloved William Blake, had expressed in words that primordial sense of wonder that is characteristic of the contemplative. But he pressed on to enter deeply into the contemplative life. One must leave poetry behind. To be a true contemplative was to give up everything for God alone. Self-denial was the path to God. In 1958, 11 years later, in the same journal, Merton wrote another essay in which he repudiated this early position. He repeated the essay, but he added a couple of pages at the beginning. In the intervening years, through study and practice, he had a richer vision of contemplation and further, a better sense that asceticism was not the goal of the contemplative life, but merely a discipline that allowed it to flourish. In a way, when I'm going to go off the text every once in a while because this is a relatively short paper because people probably want to ask questions. In a way, when Merton entered Gethsemane in 1941, the regnant note was the ascetical life, the penitential life. And it was largely due to Merton and others that they began to see that that rather modern interpretation of contemplative monasticism was not quite right. That the emphasis ought not to be on the ascetic life, but it ought to be on the contemplative life. Also, he better understood that contemplation was not a rarefied gift for the graced few, but the end of every Christian life. That's what St. Thomas Aquinas says. That's the goal of human life, is to contemplate truth. That maturation of his understanding would lead him 3 years later, in 1961, to completely rewrite this book called Seeds of Contemplation, which he had published in 1949, the year of his ordination. And he now completely rewrote it and recalled it New Seeds of Contemplation, in which he developed a rich theology of contemplation while shearing away from the two world-denying ascesis of his earlier vision. In a preface to his revisions of poetry and contemplation, Merton, in a theme that he would reiterate often, argued that he was unhappy about the notion that to be a contemplative monk was to separate the monk from the contemplative yearnings of people in general. To be a monk was a specific vocation, but it was not an exclusive one with respect to contemplation. In his famous Fourth and Walnut Epiphany, he termed the dichotomy of contemplative monk and the rest of humanity as ridiculous. It's an illusion, he says. Now, this shift in his thinking, as he himself noted, came from his deep reading in the writings of Jacques Maritain on contemplation, his encounter with personalism, a movement articulated by a French writer, Emmanuel Mounier, and in his constant reflections on the place of contemplation in the world of general humanity. But a more precise question, so those two essays are kind of interesting to read, to see what he had to say about poetry and contemplation in 1947, what he had to say about contemplation and poetry in 1958, and the differences as his own thinking began to mature. But a more precise question might be this: how did Thomas Merton harmonize his deep thirst for contemplative living with his desire to be a writer? When he first entered the monastery, he said he was going to give up all writing, wasn't going to write anymore. And he had a very wise abbot, and it was the abbot that encouraged him to write. And it was actually the abbot who encouraged him to write his autobiography. And Seven Story Mountain, which came out in 1948, was really the fruit of the efforts of his abbot to encourage him in this writing. Now, there are many ways to approach this issue, but I'm going to satisfy myself with one approach that he adopted. That approach was inspired by his reading of St. John of the Cross and the book he wrote on him, The Ascent to Truth, published in 1951. Merton was struck by John's practice of writing out dense aphoristic sayings on a short piece of paper to hand out to various people for reflection. We have over 100 of these sayings, and they are grouped together in the standard Kavanaugh translation of the works of John of the Cross as the sayings of light and love, Dikos the Luz e Amor. I think he himself called them avisos, little pieces of advice. They're extremely beautiful, and some are worthy of extended comment. I've actually memorized some of these things, they're so nice. Let me just give you two. One is, and John would write these out and hand them out and say, think about this for a week and come back and talk to me. This is the way he did spiritual guidance. Here's one. In the evening, you will be examined in love. So you have to think about that for a while. In the evening, this evening, no, probably the evening of life. And you're going to be examined, not because of how many sins you committed, but you're going to be examined in love. How well did you love? There'd be plenty to think about in that one. There's another one, which is actually my all-time favorite. And I've often said to my students, if I had the energy and the will, I could write a book on this saying. Here's John of the Cross. In the beginning, God spoke one word, and having spoken, he speaks no more, and you must hear that word in silence. A lot of theology in that. You think of the creative word of God in the book of Genesis and the incarnation and John's prologue of the gospel, etc. You could spend out a pretty hefty volume on those things. Well, in a very interesting letter to the Carthusian writer John Baptist Porion, very popular at the time, I think no one except people like me read him anymore, John Baptist Porion in 1952, Merton said that he read Bernard of Clairvaux for study, but John for contemplation. He goes on to say that in the spirit of St. John of the Cross, he is writing out little maxims for the use of his students, and he provides a couple of examples. They're very brief, so I'll give them to you in Latin and then quickly in English. These days, his scholastics would have to know some Latin. Solitudo pauperis quievit in potestate altissimi. The solitude of the poor person rests in the power of the Almighty. Here's another one. Fons vitae silentium in corde noctis. Silence is the fountain of life in the heart of darkness. Here's a third one. Nomen meum eructavit caritas ex profundis. Love rises up, brings up my name out of the depths. And the final one. Silentium celorum est mihi lex. At vita mea imago luminis. The silence of the skies is for me a law, and my life is an image of light. He goes on to say to Don Porion that a collection of 20 or 30 of maxims of this kind would make what he calls a great monastic book. Merton, however, never did compile a volume of such maxims, but he did use these maxims as the starting point for extended meditations, which became the basis for two of his very best spiritual works, Thoughts in Solitude, 1956, and New Seeds of Contemplation, in 1961. In fact, in the latter book, New Seeds of Contemplation, Merton acknowledges his inspiration is coming from the avisos of St. John of the Cross, as well as Pascal's Pensées. So here's a little tidy summary then of writing and contemplation. Deep spiritual insights expressed in terse maxims, which in turn became the object of reflection from which emerges books given as a gift to a larger audience. That's the way to think about Thoughts in Solitude. He would create these aphorisms. He would think about them himself. He would write meditations on them. And then he would offer them as a publication for a larger audience. Of course, not all of Merton's books spring from such an interior focus. He published in his lifetime, and a few books posthumously, over 60 books. And countless hundreds of poems, reviews, and essays. I have the published bibliography of his writings now 15 years out of date, and it runs to just under 800 pages. I mean, this guy was nothing if not prolific. They are not all contemplative works, but it is my conviction that they must be understood as coming from a monastic milieu. To not understand Thomas Merton as a monk is not, in my estimation, to understand him at all. Though he was an autodidact, he was a prolific writer on monastic theology and monastic culture. We may regard those writings as in service to the contemplative life. Here's an extraordinary thing that I discovered in reading the letters of Thomas Merton some years ago. When he was a very young monk, just at the time he was being ordained to the priesthood, he wrote a memorandum to the abbot of the monastery. The Trappist didn't have a central place where you could go to study. And so every monastery kind of educated its own monks. And he wrote to the abbot and he says, we're training monks completely wrongly. Now he had in mind the choir monks because it was understood in those days that if you were not a lay brother, if you weren't out there saying rosaries and slopping the hogs and cutting timber and whatnot, you were expected to go on for the priesthood. So he says, here's what's happening. He says, we train people to become priests. And the training was really kind of sad. I think one of the great merits of Merton's life is he didn't get much seminary theology. You know, he didn't spend 4 years reading these neo-scholastic textbooks. It was an old monk, had some education, would kind of drone on through the systematic and moral texts, and he'd get a little church history and so on and so forth. But he was never deeply influenced by that kind of thinking. He says, so we train these people for the priesthood, but we never train them for the monastic life. And Merton says, what we ought to have is a monastic education for monks. He said, we ought to be reading, you know, we ought to be reading the great rule of Basil. We ought to be reading Evagrius of Pontus. We ought to be reading John Cassian. We ought to be reading scholarship on St. Benedict. We ought to be reading the medieval Cistercian fathers. Most of these were not even available except in Ming's Petrology at the time. What Merton couldn't understand in 1949 when he writes this letter is that it would have to be superimposed on the seminary education that the monks were getting. So he actually started around 49-50 to create what he called monastic orientations. Some of these are now being published by Cistercian publications, but I remember being in the library of the Trappist Monastery at Gethsemane and seeing a pile of mimeograph manuscripts, and I'm not kidding you, that would be that tall. Merton would crank these things out on the old mimeograph machines in order to give the monks under his care some monastic formation in addition to what they were getting through these seminary texts. You know, and he almost single-handedly brought back the value of the solitary life in Cistercian monasticism. So he contributed a great deal to monastic formation. Now, his keen interest in both social justice and his concern for ecumenical and interreligious dialogue, and by the way, this was an interest that was encouraged by letter, both by Pope John the 23rd and both by Paul the 6th, who told him, this is a task that you need to keep up. All of this interest was rooted in his conviction that the contemplative voice, at best from the margins, needed to be a voice in the conversation about the great issues of the day, which in his case was conversations on racism, the need for peace, religious understanding, and so on. As he said famously in an exchange with the great Benedictine scholar Jean Leclerc, the future of monasticism was not going to be merely survival, but prophecy. The monastic voice ought to be a prophetic voice. Now, he understood as well as everyone that not everybody was called upon to be a Thomas Merton to write on these issues. But he says it would be a shame in the history of the church if there were not contemplatives who would add their voice to the other voices that are concerned with the great issues of the day. Now, we can fairly ask why the best of his writing, and I say best because he knew that some of his writing was really terrible. We have, and you can find it, it's been reproduced. In 1967, he wrote a fever chart, like the fever chart. He did a fever chart on his writing, and underneath it was said, terrible, not good, okay. I think the best was, he said, fairly good. And he did lines like this. Some of the writing that he did, he was forced to do. He was simply the abbot, needed to buy a new tractor, so he said, write a book on this or write a book on that. So some of this stuff was not very good at all. I mean, some of it is kind of embarrassing to look at. But some of it is going to endure. And the simple answer to that question about how did he have an authentic capacity for writing powerfully for people is to be found, in my estimation, because he could write about God and about religious truth in a manner that was compelling. He was incapable of sentimental cliches. He very much distrusted kind of ecclesiastical language. His writings do not sound like papal encyclicals or letters from the local bishop, etc. They ring with a certain degree of authenticity. But he never sounded technical or pious. And the best of his writing rang with the authenticity of deep personal experience. And I want to give you an example which is going to require me to read a couple lines of Thomas Merton. But he always sounds better than I do, so you're going to be happy about this in the long run. Here's a curious thing about his writing habits. He kept a journal from the time he was a student at Columbia University. And those journals have subsequently been published. I edited the volume from 1952 to 1960. I transcribed from his rather meticulous handwriting all of the entries that he wrote from the time he wrote Sign of Jonas up until 1960. Then another editor took up the next text. It was a lot of work. Merton, for example, would say in his journal, a great article in La Vie Spirituelle on X. But he would never tell you what year the journal was or what month it was or anything. And I'd trot over to the library to look through the back issues. And I kind of figure, well, he was writing now, so he had to have read it before. And the topic was such and so on. The other thing is that he was a polyglot. He spoke, he was a complete French speaker. He spoke Italian, he spoke Spanish. He translated out of Spanish. He knew some German, and he would cite various languages in his writings. And I always remember the day I was in my office, and I turned the page, and he was in correspondence with Boris Pasternak, the great Russian writer. They exchanged correspondence for some time. And Merton says in his journal, I think I'm going to learn Russian. And I thought, oh, God, no, not Russian. I can handle the Latin, I can handle the Italian, the Spanish, and the French, and I can muddle my way through the German, but please, not Russian. But he gave that idea up. Well, here's what he would do. We actually have in his journals a description of the fire watch, which is the epilogue of Sign of Jonas, and a piece of writing that Jacques Maritain says was the greatest piece of writing that Merton never did. It's a beautiful piece. But if you read in the journal what he says about the fire watch, it's a pretty pedestrian text. They had a custom, every monk had to take a turn of staying up all night, going from room to room, floor to floor in the monastery, and with a clock, and they got a pair of sneakers and a flashlight, and they would check the time and see there was no fire in this part of the building, and so on, because they had had some devastating fires at the monastery over the years. And in his journal, he writes about this and about how, in a way, it's a kind of an archaeological trip to go through the monastery, etc. And it ends with him going into the church, climbing up into the belfry, and then looking out over the Kentucky Knobs, where Gethsemane is located. When it comes time to publish this account in the epilogue to the Sign of Jonas, dated July 4th, 1952, the written version in Sign of Jonas is far denser and deeper and more poetic than the description in the notebook. And this kind of gives you a clue as to how he wrote. He would take the events, in this particular case, a kind of a ordinary event, and he would think about it, turn it into a kind of a meditation on the deeper significance of it, and then rewrite it in a much more formal way. And I've often thought of the famous definition of poetry of William Wordsworth. Wordsworth said that poetry is emotion recollected in tranquility. So you have the emotion, recollecting it, and then in the tranquility of the poet's study or whatever, you write this out. Well, Merton did something similar in his writing. So from the rather schematic, almost geographical description of traveling through the monastery in July of 1952, Merton rewrites the meditation. And it's longish, I'm not gonna read much of it, but I wanna read the part where Merton climbs up the belfry of the old bell tower of the church, now long gone, and out of the heat of the monastery. He writes this: I climbed the trembling, twisted stair into the belfry. I've seen the fuse box. I've looked at the corner where I think there's some wiring. I'm satisfied there's no fire in the tower that would flare like a great torch and take the whole abbey up with it in 20 minutes. Next paragraph is the paragraph I'm interested in. And now my whole being breathes the wind which blows through the belfry, and my hand is on the door through which I see the heavens. The door swings out upon a vast sea of darkness and of prayer. Will it come to this, the moment of my death? Is my death going to be like passing through a door into the vastness of the universe? Will you open a door upon the great forest and set my feet upon a ladder under the moon and take me out among the stars? The roof glistens under my feet, this long metal roof facing the forest and the hills, where I stand higher than the treetops and walk upon the shining air. Mists of damp heat rise up out of the fields around the sleeping abbey. The whole valley is flooded with moonlight, and I can count the southern hills beyond the water tank and almost number the trees of the forest to the north. Now the huge chorus of living beings rise up out of the world beneath my feet, singing on the watercourses, throbbing in the creeks and the fields and the trees, choirs of millions and millions of jumping and flying and creeping things. And far above me, the cool sky opens upon the frozen distance of the stars. I lay the clock upon the belfry ledge and pray cross-legged with my back against the tower and face the same unanswered questions. Lord God of this great night, do you see the woods? Do you hear the rumor of their loneliness? Do you behold their secrecy? Do you remember their solitudes? Do you see that my soul is beginning to dissolve like wax within me? Clamabo per diem et non exaudies, et nocte et non incipientia amici, line from Psalm 22. I will cry through the day and you will not listen, and in the night and you do not listen to me. Do you remember the place in the stream? Do you remember the top of the vineyard knobs? That time in autumn when the train was in the valley? Do you remember McGinty's Hollow? Do you remember the thinly wooded hillside behind Hanekamp's place? Do you remember the time of the forest fire? Do you know what has become of the little poplars we planted in the spring? There is not a leaf that is not in your care. There is no cry that was not heard by you before it was uttered. There is no water in the shales that was not hidden there by your wisdom. There is no concealed spring that was concealed by you. There is no glen for a lone house that was not planted by you for a lone house. There is no man for that acre of woods that was not made by you for that acre of woods. But there is greater comfort in the substance of silence than in the answer to a question. Eternity is in the present. Eternity is in the palm of the hand. Line from William Blake. Eternity is a seed of fire whose sudden roots break barriers that keep my heart from being an abyss. And he goes on for another page. And he ends with this as the sun is coming up. There are drops of dew that show like sapphire in the grass as soon as the great sun appears, and leaves stir behind the hushed flight of an escaping dove. Those are great lines. Now, if you look at them carefully, what you see in those lines is this reaction to an event which he earlier described in a far more prosaic fashion, in which he described the fire watch. The same is true of Fourth and Walnut, the famous passage in Fourth and Walnut. If you look at the notebook description, it's pretty standard. You know, I'm in town at the corner of 4th and Walnut. I've gone down to the corner of 4th and Walnut. It's now 4th and Muhammad Ali, and they have a big sign, a state sign, that quotes a passage from Conjectures of a Guilty Bystander. And so he describes that in the notebooks. But when you read it in Conjectures of a Guilty Bystander, it's much more thickened up. It's much more poetic. It's much more deeply spiritual. And if you pay attention to those texts, and I've taught these texts many, many times and think about them a lot, they almost take the form of a prayer. They're almost like a prayerful response to events that had happened in the past. Now, my kind of theory on this is that a good deal of his best writing, and a lot of his really great writing, shows up in letters that he writes, especially in the letters that are collected by Brother Patrick Hart, entitled The School of Charity, letters on spiritual direction and the spiritual life. You get this sense that he had a very, very profound life of prayer, which he experienced, and which, by the way, even though he's a very autobiographical writer, he almost never describes his interior life of prayer. Those of you who know his writings well will note that in the early 1960s, he writes some letters to a man he's never met, a Sufi, a Muslim, who lived in Karachi, Pakistan, named Abdul Aziz. And Merton at this time is living in the Hermitage. And Abdul Aziz writes and says, "Well, what is your prayer life like?" And Merton writes back to him and he says, "Normally I don't talk about stuff like this." He said, "But I'm going to describe my prayer in terms that you will understand." And there's a beautiful long passage in which he says that his contemplative prayer was simply being in the presence of God. And that he says, if all of a sudden I start thinking about something, and anyone who's read the great mystics will recognize this right away, he said, "I've lost contact and I need to go back to that simplicity again." That's one of the few times he ever talks about that. And he could be extremely irreverent. And he was certainly very human. But he couldn't stand falsity in religion. There's a place in the notebooks where he's listening to Abbot James, a guy with whom he had very difficult relationships over a long period of time. And ironically, they're buried right next to each other in Gethsemane. And the monks always say, "Well, there's Abbot James and Father Lewis fighting each other for all eternity." One time they were in the chapter room, and Abbot James, who was a very smart guy with an MBA from Harvard Business School and knew how to run the monastery, but was very pious in a way, was talking about how he was telling the monks, "You need to have Jesus as your buddy." Next line of Merton Singh says, "I walked out to the garth and wanted to throw up." You know, just that was just a little bit too much for him. But there is in his life, I think, a certain ring of authenticity. And because I know that there's people from the International Thomas Merton Society, and you may have lots of questions on other things, I'm going to end in just a second. But I want to read something. This is just a little short paragraph, and I think it perfectly sums up how Merton functioned as a contemplative and how that stands behind Merton as a writer. Very short. Merton said to his students, his novices, "Life is this simple. We are living in a world that is absolutely transparent, and the divine is shining through it all the time. This is just not a nice story or a fable. It's true." And finishing with Thomas Merton's words, I think I shall also stop and allow you all to make comments or vilify the speaker or or ask questions. And let me conclude by saying I've been a college teacher for over 40 years. So I'm going to stop and pause, and if no one has a hand up in 30 seconds, I'm going to start calling on people. No. I wouldn't do that. Thank you all very much.